You know what talented veteran teams do? They take their game plan and ram it down their opponent's throat, even when their opponent is intent on stopping that very plan.
You are Locked On Tar Heels, your daily podcast on the UNC Tar Heels, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
Hey there, it's Friday, March 22nd, 2024. Welcome into the Locked On Tar Heels podcast, the only daily North Carolina show out there. I'm your host, Isaac Shade, and you're joining us at the place to get your Tar Heels content every single day. Thanks for making us your first listen or watch. Special shout out to all of you everydayers out there as well. This episode is brought to you by Nissan. Are you the kind of driver that likes to push things a little further? You ever wonder what adventure could be waiting just around the next corner? Well, why don't you take the Nissan Rogue or Pathfinder or Armada and go find your next big adventure? Check them all out today at NissanUSA.com. Woo, the Tar Heels are still dancing, baby. 90-62 victory over Wagner on Thursday. The 132nd all-time NCAA tournament win for the Tar Heels. That is the most of any program in the nation. So coming up on the show today, then, we're going to have our Four Corners recap of the game. We'll have our Shady Stat. Then in segment three, we'll go on ahead to looking towards Michigan State and that matchup. But first, we got to get to the very biggest takeaway from this game. And it's what I said in the cold open, that this is the sign of a veteran, a mature and experienced team. They have a game plan and they execute it. They exert their will. And despite the fact that Wagner's game plan was in direct opposition to Carolina's game plan to stop them from doing their exact thing, Carolina went out and did it. What was that game plan? Well, it was obvious. Wagner has only one player that's over 6'7". So what do? You get it inside early and often and always. And what I love is that Carolina did that exact thing and did so while having still a lot of balance to their offensive attack and approach in this game. Well, obviously, the center and the focus, anytime you say, all right, guys, we got to get it inside, who's it going to be? Armando Bacot. It was clear and evident right out of the gate that that was the plan. All told, when all was said and done, Mondo finishes with 20 points, 15 rebounds, five of which were offensive. Pretty funny because I called my shot on Wednesday, but really I was just throwing it out there as like kind of the baseline number I was looking for. I said, you know, based on what I think the game plan should be and will be based on what Wagner has, I'm expecting a 20 and 15 game out of Armando, but just meaning like 20 points, 15 rebounds, and it's fine if he gets like 22 and 17 or something. But he ended up getting exactly 20 and 15. So you know what? Saturday against Michigan State, Armando needs 30 and 18. You know, like maybe now I'm just prognosticating and it's all going to come true. Very seriously, Armando probably could have named a number in this game. Carolina didn't really need him down the stretch. And if they needed to attack that way more, they could have and gotten even more numbers. But for Armando, had a double-double in the first half. It's his seventh straight double-double in the NCAA tournament. Remember, Carolina didn't get there last year, and he had six straight in 2022. It's his sixth straight NCAA tournament game with 15 or more rebounds, his 86th total career double-double. That ties Kenneth Faried third all-time in NCAA history, and he's now just one shy of tying Tim Duncan for the most in ACC history and the tying for the second most in NCAA history. Absolutely ridiculous stuff that Armando Bacot has done in his career. And, oh, by the way, passed Phil Ford to move into second place on the Carolina all-time scoring list. And I know there's probably a lot of like Corey Alexander-ish voices of us out here saying, yeah, but it was 5 years. I hear it. I get it. And I agree with that, but he's done it. And that's what the record book is going to show, that Tyler Hansbrough, Armando Bacot, Phil Ford are the top three scorers in Carolina history. So obviously, as I said, Armando is the center of that attack. Carolina went out and executed and did it wonderfully. If you want to put some more numbers on it, like the fact that it wasn't just Armando Bacot, that Carolina is getting into the rim and attacking both through entry pass and through dribble drive and scoring at the rim that way. Carolina held the advantage in points at the paint, 48 to 20. That's the story of the game to me. That, you know, if it wasn't here, it would be the shady stat of the game. But because it's such the story of the game to me, we got to go ahead and talk about it and look at it here. 48-20 in the paint. I mean, that's a ridiculous margin that Carolina had with that. And so really, really good stuff there by the Tar Heels in the paint. And as part of it, look, in this day and age, in basketball, three-pointers and taking a big volume of them is just part of the game. And so a lot of times, if a coach comes and says to you, hey, look, we've got a massive advantage inside and we got to take care of it throughout the entirety of this game. You look at your coach and you think, okay, that's great and that's cute, but we're still going to shoot a bunch of threes in the process, right? Like, that's just what we're going to do, coach. So you need to get on board with that. But here's what I love. That Carolina, again, this is another part of being so bought into this game plan, did not start settling for threes. They were so intent on getting the ball inside that their first three-point attempt was not until there were 12 and a half minutes left in the first half. That's basically 7.5 minutes of game time before RJ Davis took and made a very deep three-pointer. And what I also love is that Carolina, you know, they started slow from deep, 2 of 7 in the first half, but then in the second half, went off 7 of 11 from three to go 9 of 18 for the game from deep. That's exactly 50%. But that's the kind of thing that can happen when you do a great job of establishing yourself inside first. It's like establishing the run game in football. So you can hit a home run outside so that Drake May can find Tez Walker in stride. Like that, that's the kind of thing that we're talking about here. And that's exactly what Carolina did. So really, really impressive stuff to dominate inside, allow it to open up the outside, and then make hay from there in the second half. And as part of all of this, it's not just Armando. Yet again, it is a balanced approach. Carolina showed an ability to win in multiple ways and with multiple players. The Tar Heels had three different players get to 16 or more points in this game. Mondo had those 20 that we talked about. RJ Davis had 22, a ridiculous second half where he scored 17 of those. Because again, that's where RJ, part of that maturity that we're talking about again, is the second half. RJ's like, all right, I got this one, right? And then goes off. And not to mention that third player who had 16 or more points, Jae'lyn Withers. We'll talk more about him in a minute, but unreal. When you can get him as your third scorer and you get 16 out of that, take that every day of the week. But you also had Cormac Ryan chipping in 13 in this game, a very quiet 13. Harrison Ingram had 9, and it was fine because at 9, he was the fifth leading scorer in this basketball game. It's great. It's fine. There will be games when Carolina needs Harrison Ingram to have more points, maybe even Saturday against Michigan State. And if that's the case, maybe he'll do so. 8 total different Tar Heels scored, 26 bench points. So Carolina, let me sum it up again, executed their game plan even while Wagner is trying to literally stop them from doing that. Wagner's coach said, we need to make them shooters. Carolina refused to allow that to happen, even against their zone. Particularly in the first half. Now, I mentioned Jae'lyn Withers, who legitimately had his best game as a Tar Heel at the most critical and important time. We'll talk about that along with the rest of the Four Corners recap and the shady stat of the game, all coming up in just a second. Right after I tell you about our brand new sponsor, Manscaped, this episode is brought to you by the spring cleaning champions, Manscaped. This season, make sure to groom your carpet and the drapes with the leaders in below-the-waist grooming. Clean out that winter bush with Manscaped, with Manscaped's Lawnmower 5.0 and watch your confidence bloom like the springtime flowers. Embrace the season. Join 10 million men worldwide who trust Manscaped with our special offer. Go to Manscaped and use manscaped.com and use code LOCKEDON for 20% off plus free shipping. This fifth generation trimmer features 2 interchangeable next gen skin safe blade heads. I need that skin safe, a standard one for taking a little off the top and a new foil blade to go smooth wherever your heart desires. Spring cleaning also doesn't just apply to the nether regions. Get the full grooming experience with Manscaped's signature Beard Hedger Pro kit, plus Handyman Electric Face Shaver. So whether you're looking to craft your signature look or clean up that neckline, these are always the right tools for the job. Get 20% off and free shipping with the code LOCKEDON at manscaped.com. That's 20% off and free shipping with the code LOCKEDON at manscaped.com. Nothing like a little spring cleaning for you. This episode is also brought to you by Game Time. Do you need last-minute tickets for the NCAA tournament? Perhaps, you weren't expecting a team to go further. Maybe you're an Oakland fan out there and you knocked off Kentucky. Your team made it further than you thought. Now you're scrambling for tickets, but you're worried you can't find good tickets or good deals. No worries. Game Time has you. They're the fast and easy way to buy tickets for all the sports, music, comedy, theater events, and more near you. With killer last-minute deals, all-in prices, views from your seat, and a best price guarantee, Game Time is the only ticketing app that gives you complete peace of mind with your purchase. With zone deals, you pick the section and Game Time picks the seats for big time savings. So take the guesswork out of buying tickets with Game Time, where you can buy tickets in seconds with just two taps. Download the Game Time app, create an account, and use code LOCKEDON for $20 off your first purchase. Again, create an account and redeem code LOCKEDON for $20 off. Terms apply. Download Game Time today. Last minute tickets, lowest prices guaranteed. Four Corners recap and our shady stat of the game all coming at you right now as we continue unpacking Carolina's 90-62 win over Wagner in the opening round of the 24 NCAA tournament. We got to start with Jae'lyn Withers. How have we gone this long without, I know we touched on his 16 points, but Jae'lyn Withers, it's a season high, the 16 points. He also had 10 rebounds, four of which were offensive. He also had three assists, tied with Elliot Cadeau for the most on the team. This was his second ever double-double as a Tar Heel. That first dub-dub came against Louisville. You remember that. Also critically, here's what happened. Jae'lyn Withers came into this game at 14:42 of the first half and completely changed the energy. We talk about this aggressiveness. We talk about Carolina having the grit and the edge and attacking. Jae'lyn Withers was the one that inhabited that more than any other Tar Heel. He checks in, again, 14:42, and in the next 4 minutes and 41 seconds of game time, he took 8 free throws because he was attacking, getting Wagner in all sorts of foul trouble. He drew the most fouls on the team, 5, drew more fouls than Armando Bacot, anyone else, because he was getting in, mixing it up. I mentioned those 4 offensive rebounds. I should have gone back and looked, but I think 3 of the 4, if I'm remembering correctly, were then putbacks immediately. I know there were back-to-back, which were putbacks right after Wagner hit back-to-back threes in the second half. Like, that was critical, great stuff. And oh, by the way, those 3 assists, that was a season high, and just 1 turnover with those. So important. Everything Jae'lyn Withers did, just bringing that energy. And oh, that dunk, by the way. Can we just remember that dunk and how great it was? Really, really good stuff. Jae'lyn Withers, get all your flowers, my dude, because that was a great performance. But here's what I'm going to say. Please bring that energy over and over and over again as long as this season continues to ride. Number 2 in our Four Corners recap. It was a bit of a tough day for Elliot Cadeau. I think we can just acknowledge that. Interestingly, like, he still had a good plus minus. I think it was plus 15. I'm looking back at it right now. But in terms of his own production, there just weren't many stats there from a shooting standpoint. And while I said he tied Jae'lyn Withers with 3 assists, did have 4 turnovers. So just some issues for Elliot in his first ever NCAA tournament game. And I get it. In some ways, the moment felt a little big for him. 0 points, 0 of 2 on field goals, just two field goal attempts. And one of them was in the first couple minutes of the game. Didn't get to the free throw line at all. Did have 3 rebounds. We'll take that. And then, as I said, 3 assists, 4 turnovers in 19 minutes of play. And so while I will say that the moment felt a little big, hear me also say that this, the difference for North Carolina, and I named this on Thursday's show as well, as opposed to, Kentucky, is that when Elliot Cadeau is having a tough day, RJ Davis can take over. And even if RJ needs a blow and it's not ready for Elliot yet, Seth Trimble can handle things just fine. Thank you very much. So Carolina is in a great position. That's part of the brilliance of the construction of this team. Hubert Davis knows that there's going to be tough days for Elliot Cadeau, but he also knows that he's got a Final Four point guard behind Elliot Cadeau, who, oh, by the way, just also happens to be the ACC player of the year. Like, that's the place Carolina is in. And it's worth figuring out what's going to be a good day or not for Elliot, because you go back to that Florida State game a while in the ACC tournament, that's a great version of Elliot Cadeau, right? And so that's what we need. Kentucky's problem, as we all saw on Thursday, is that when their freshmen are struggling, that's all they got to rely on. And then John Calipari is going to throw him under the bus. And it's like, homie, look, I get it, but you've made this freshman bed. Now you got to lie in it. That's not the bed Carolina's in. It's like, oh, it's okay, Elliot. Go sit on the bench for a little bit. We'll get you figured out. I expect great things from him on Saturday against Michigan State. Not frustrated or disappointed or anything. But this is what happens to a lot of freshmen in their first NCAA tournament game. All right. Four Corners recap point number three is turnovers. Look, this was a struggle in the first half, particularly. Carolina had 9 total turnovers. 6 of them came in that first 20 minutes. And what's funny is that now, as you zoom out and look at it and realize 9 turnovers, it's like, oh, okay. But in real time with those 6, it felt bigger than it was. And here's why. 5 of those 6 were on passes. 4 of those passes led to live ball turnovers. And so it felt really bad because it was in the moment turnovers. And 2 of them were outlet passes. And so it was kind of, it just felt bigger than it was, leads to, I think in the first half, it was 9 total points off of turnovers for Wagner. Let me look at it really quick here. Yes. First half, 9 points off of turnovers for Wagner. So it's like, in that moment, we're feeling like, man, this is not great. It's not overwhelming. It's not, you know, double digit first half turnovers like we've seen, but it did feel bad. And it did lead to 9 first half points off of turnovers for Wagner. The only thing that kept this from going ahead and being a bigger blowout than it was in the first half. But here's what I want to commend the Tar Heels on. They got it figured out. The second half came back and just 3 turnovers, the first of which was an Elliot Cadeau offensive foul in like the first minute or so of the second half. So that means final 19 minutes, just 2 turnovers. And big picture, again, I know how the first half felt for all of us. I felt that too. In the second half, as we said, Carolina committed just 3 turnovers, held Wagner to just 2 points off of those 3 turnovers. And big picture, this is the 3rd straight game for Carolina only having single digit turnovers. And that's not like a thing that they're doing a bunch of. This is just the 2nd time all season Carolina has had a stretch of 3 games with single digit turnovers. They have a chance against Michigan State to turn that into 4 straight games with single digit turnovers. And I would expect them to do so, especially like Elliot. You know how hard he is on himself. He's going to be locked into changing that. And I think that's part of it. That 4 of those 9 were Elliot Cadeau. Now that he's got his feet wet, I don't think we'll see that again on Saturday. Mondo was the only other player with multiple turnovers, and he only had 2. And so all in all, looking back on it, I feel okay with Carolina's turnovers as they were. But you got to clean that up from the first half. Number 4 from this game. Seth Trimble has become a little bit of a playmaker lately, and we might not have even realized it. Since returning from injury, that was the 2 games he missed were at home against Clemson, that game Carolina lost that I believe they would have won with him. And then he missed the game at Miami that Carolina won. But since returning from those games, from those missed games, the rest of the way, Seth has accumulated 16 assists against just 6 turnovers. That's an assist to turnover ratio of 2.67 from like your 3rd guard. So again, when I say it's okay if Elliot's having a little bit of struggle, because here comes RJ. And if you still want RJ to play the 2 guard, play off the ball, fine. Let Seth run the show. Because Seth Trimble is really coming into his own in a multitude of ways. He had a 3-pointer on Thursday. Like, doing all these things, really, really encouraging. Just so good to see Seth really stepping up in all these ways. All right, shady stat of the game coming at you. As I said, in a lot of games, I would have used points in the paint as the shady stat of the game because it was so overwhelming, but I really wanted to include it as that first part. So here's what we are going with. Carolina out-rebounds Wagner 43-24. That's a plus 19 rebounding margin, meaning that the Tar Heels have had a double-digit rebounding margin in four of their last five games. That is insane. Carolina has 24 straight games this season leading the rebounding battle in the game. And in total, they have out-rebounded their opponents in 31 of their 35 games this season. Really, really good stuff, and something that's going to continue to allow Carolina to stay in games, because even when the shots aren't falling, which, you know, they were in a big way on Thursday against Wagner, Carolina for the game shot 55%. That's not going to happen every game. So how do you take care of business when the shots aren't falling? You hold on to defensive rebounds and you get as many offensive rebounds as you can. Well, Carolina, if they want to keep that going, that rebounding, it's a quick turnaround to Michigan State on Saturday, but it's tournament time, and that's what we do, quick turnarounds. Michigan State prep, including the Four Corners preview, coming up in just a second. Right after I tell you that this episode is brought to you by Nissan, this week's March Madness bracket highlight is coming right at you from our good friends at Nissan. Each week, we're picking one team that stands out, a team that's pushed it further than the rest. Just like any of the all-new 2024 Nissan SUVs, these guys were able to take it to the next level. You know, because we've talked about it, that the Oregon Ducks are obviously this week's Nissan Rogue. This team surprised us all with a powerful performance in the Pac-12 tournament, punching their ticket to the big dance. And then they went on and followed it up by knocking off who? South Carolina on Thursday in the first round of the NCAA tournament. Great stuff. They say win life, go Rogue. And that's exactly what the Ducks have done. So take the Nissan Rogue or Pathfinder or Armada and go find your next big adventure. Shop NissanUSA.com. Carolina gets to stick around and play round two of the NCAA tournament thanks to that opening round win over Wagner. We already knew the opponent because we saw Michigan State kind of spank Mississippi State in the first game of Thursday. A pretty solid performance from Tom Izzo's club, who's not had a solid season. And we now have the tip times for that. This is very late Thursday that I'm recording this, so thankfully we already have it. Stayed up to watch the end of the Kansas and Samford game. Boy, what a terrible missed call that was. Did anybody stay up and see that? Because then we were, my co-host Andy Patton and I from Locked On College Basketball, were recording a live show after that, live postcast like we do after the Tar Heels games, which we'll do again Friday night after everything's done. So come hang out with us if you want. Anyway, North Carolina, Michigan State, 5:30 p.m. Eastern time Saturday on CBS. The FanDuel line is out, has Carolina favored by just 3.5 points. I thought it would be a bigger line. But, you know, it's not. So that might help you. Carolina. I said this on Twitter on Thursday afternoon and got a little bit of backlash for it. Carolina is 5-0 all time against Michigan State in the NCAA tournament. People were mad at me for jinxing Carolina. I hear that. I understand it. I'm very superstitious myself. So I apologize and I'm knocking on wood as we speak. But I don't take it back, because Carolina has never lost to Michigan State, and now's not the time to start doing so. But a reminder, let's get into talking about Michigan State. This team preseason was number 4. Now, they lost their opening game to James Madison, and then they just were kind of off the radar in those terms the rest of the way. But it's been a struggle this season. They just got to their 20th win by winning the NCAA tournament first round. Like, that just then was their 20th win of the season, beating Mississippi State. So now they're 20-14. They were just 10-10 in Big Ten play. That's it. 500 basketball in Big Ten play. They started off the season, as I said, losing to James Madison. But yet, through all of that, they're still 16th at KenPom. So there's some level of efficiency to them. There's not, as I look at Michigan State and look at them play and their stats and numbers, there's no real skill set that they're elite at. There's nothing that's like, this is what could really scare you about Michigan State. But they are solid, right? There's no glaring deficiencies either. And so they're just right there, and they're a veteran team, and you got to be ready to go. In terms of player to know, the most dominant player you need to know is Tyson Walker. He's a fifth-year, six-foot guard, very similar to somebody that plays for our own Tar Heels. Their leading scorer, 18.2 points a game. So I'm looking for that matchup, assuming that Tyson Walker and RJ Davis will guard each other. Should be a lot of fun, and you know what happens when a team doesn't have size on RJ Davis. So maybe they'll put somebody else on him. We'll see. Their other starters are Malik Hall, who's a 6'7 forward. It's his fifth year as well. He's had some troubles with injuries in his career, but when he's in and healthy, he's a dude. Super athletic. I love watching him play. Also, Jaden Akins, who had a great game against Mississippi State. It's his third year. He's a 6'4 guard. And then AJ Hogard, who it's his fourth year. He's another 6'3 guard. So kind of smaller size around the perimeter there. Now, Tom Izzo has tinkered with his fifth starting spot lately, but the last three games have all been Carson Cooper, a 6'11 sophomore center. So we'll see if that's who they go with again to give that size up against Armando Bacot. As we always do, let me give you my four corners preview for this game. Number one, very similar to North Carolina this year. If, you know, I said there's nothing really elite about Michigan State, but where they do most stand out is their defense. Their defense rates at KenPom quite similarly to Carolina's, actually. But the thing with Michigan State is that Carolina's offense is still pretty highly ranked at KenPom, you know, within the top 25. Let's see what happened to it. Let me refresh KenPom after. Wow, Carolina's offense has jumped into the top 20 now. They are 19th. At KenPom in offensive efficiency. That's great. Way to go, Tar Heels. But for Michigan State, it ain't there. Michigan State's is a good bit lower. They are 52nd in offensive efficiency. So while the defense is going to be there and both of these offenses are going to have to go up against those defenses, Carolina projects to be able to do that more capably. Although I will say, I thought Michigan State's offense looked pretty efficient on Thursday against a Mississippi State defense that's pretty good as well. So we'll see what happens there. Number two, that blue-collar edge will have to be there. We've been using this Jay Billis quote that I've kind of tweaked a little bit to say that Carolina is a blue-blood program with a blue-collar mentality. Pat Kilby earlier this week talked about the edge that Carolina needs to play with, and that has to be in this game in spades. Think back to some of these regular season matchups against Michigan State. We've seen a team or two get roughed up by a difficult Michigan State team against Tom Izzo, right? Like Carolina not only is undefeated against Michigan State in the in NCAA tournament play, they've done really well against Michigan State, not undefeated, but done really well in regular season. But we know that these Tom Izzo teams are always tough. And if Carolina doesn't bring that intensity, doesn't bring that we're getting every 50-50 ball, doesn't bring that same thing that Jae'lyn Withers was bringing on Thursday, you could go out and lose this game. Why? Part of it is because Michigan State is a very experienced team, just like the Tar Heels are. They've been around the block. They know what they're doing, and they're not going to beat themselves. So Carolina's got to go stick it to them. You expect to see that. All right, four corners preview point number three, protect the paint. When you look at where Michigan State scoring comes from, the vast majority of it is two-point range, 56.6%, in fact. That's 29th in the country in terms of point distribution coming from 2 points. And so what Carolina needs to do, you know, a lot of teams in this day and age, Carolina's getting out, guarding the three, running teams off the line. And I'm not saying they shouldn't do that, because Michigan State will knock it down if you leave them open. But Carolina needs to just be ready to defend inside the three-point line in this game, which is not necessarily what they're always used to in this day and age. So that's just something to be aware of, that the defensive strategy might look a little bit different here. And so, folks, we need to be ready to watch out for that. Fourth in our four corners preview for Michigan State, we talked about Elliot Cadeau. And obviously there's grace there because you've got RJ Davis and Seth Trimble behind you. But here we go, round of 32, another Power 6 conference opponent, Michigan State. this is going to be need to be a better all-around floor game from Elliot Cadeau. You know, you want to see the assists. You want to see fewer turnovers. You want to see him get to the basket and finish a couple times, be able to knock down a three if he needs to, draw some fouls, get to the free throw line. It's that Florida State game. I mentioned it earlier, but that Florida State game, you remember, I talked about it after that game. Elliot Cadeau was the dominant factor in that basketball game. I need to see that version of him on Saturday. You know that he wants to see that version of him. I know he's so frustrated with Thursday's performance. He's going to get that figured out, but that's what we need to see, because the rest of these experienced guys, they're going to be able to bring it, but Elliot is the one that's got to bring all that together and make it work and click. And oh, by the way, remember I said Michigan State is really experienced? That veteran backcourt is going to be out to get him, and he can't let that happen. He's got to be ready to go and lead the troops. I expect him to be able to do so, but we got to watch out for it. All right, gang, and a Friday. Thankfully, we don't have to stress about watching the Tar Heels, so just enjoy another beautiful and brilliant day of the NCAA tournament. It's going to be great. Can't wait for that. If you're not part of the Locked On Tar Heels Discord community, come join us. The link is in the show notes. It's free to be a part of. If you haven't subscribed to the show on video and audio, please do that. Also, make sure to hit that bell notification on YouTube, because you'll get a notification as soon as I go live after the game on Saturday. It's always a great day to be a Tar Heel, especially when the Tar Heels are still rolling right along in the tournament. We'll talk again on Saturday after the game, but until then, peace.